So we have with us today Deepesh, Anurag, Satwik. We congratulate them on their huge success in the Indian Forest Service Examination 2017. And we also congratulate them and thank them on behalf of ForumIAS and accepting our invitation and to share their success story with the future candidates who are aspiring to be part of this prestigious examination. Thank you very much.
So why Forest Service? What motivated you to take up Forest Service?
I think there can be multiple reasons for joining Forest Service, but you need to understand that Forest Service is one of the three prestigious All India services. So in each district, there are three officers. One is an IAS, one is an IPS, and one is an IFS. An IFS officer takes care of the entire forest area in the district, and also whatever PWD related works and other developmental works, they need forest clearance. So in that sense, people need to realize that Forest Service is at par with the other central or all India services and offers a lot of opportunity and responsibility. So I think people need to shed their notions about Forest Service that they'll be working in jungles and they'll be dealing with animals. That is not at all the case. I mean, that is part of the job and that will be a fun experience too. And later on also, right now the second highest number of joint secretaries are from Indian Forest Service. So there's a very good
career progression
in Indian Forest Service. So I would like more and more people to actually apply for Indian Forest Service, and actually it's very doable too. The level of competition and uncertainty and the chances are better for Forest Service. So that is the reason.
What's your take, Anurag?
Yeah, as Deepesh already mentioned, this is a very prestigious service. And now, as far as the preparation part is concerned, we already post UPSC mains, because post UPSC mains we have 2 months. So even if people don't have science optional in UPSC, they should also apply for the Forest Service. 2 months time, they can give a dedicated
it's
effort.
Sufficient
effort. And they can very well clear it. Yeah.
Anything to add, Satwik?
I would say that considering the fact that we are putting too much focus on environment nowadays, and if someone is really interested, so this is the job.
So for all of these officers will improve and increase over
yes,
time.
Because considering after the Paris Climate Summit, we have so much funds and so much efforts are being done to save forests. So if your environmental ethics are basically aligned, environmental ethics can also get aligned with the service. So I think this is the best job for the person who loves nature and who also seeks government job, because if you are, you know, nature lover, you are just not cannot go for natural hiking and all these things. You can actually contribute to the nation building.
Another interesting thing about this exam is that this has a higher cutoff in prelims in comparison to civil services. So how did you guys manage? I think that's something that all our viewers would be interested to know. What was your strategy for prelims?
Because as we all know that the cutoff for this particular examination is 10-15 marks more than the civil service examination. The first hurdle in this examination is clearing the prelims. So can we just walk through what was your strategy for each and every subject which is part of the prelims examination with regard to the sources? And also, like, what was your overall strategy in terms of taking tests, revising the syllabus? So, can we just walk through the things? Can we start with Deepesh?
So, as sir mentioned, that prelims is actually the most important phase, especially for Forest Service. Regarding the preparation, I think, first of all, we cannot ignore prelims. A lot of effort has to be put in. Secondly, revision makes a lot of difference. People spread out their resources, but they do not revise them well, and ultimately, you end up forgetting. Because you need to understand that there are around 40 to 50 questions out of 100 that most of the people will get correct, and you too have to get it correct. And that can only be done through thorough revision. For the remaining next 30 questions, you will have to find cues from your memory, because you won't be able to answer them directly. Again, revision becomes important. And then there are 10 to 20 questions which probably you will not won't know or have very little idea about. You can leave them or take a guess if you are getting a feeling. But ultimately, revision forms the most important part.
How many questions did you guess this time?
I think I was very sure on around 50 questions. And for the remaining 48 questions that I attempted, there was a varying degree of guess, I would say.
One important thing with respect to prelims is the number of questions that you attempted. How many questions did you guys attempt?
I attempted 98.
I attempted 93, and I think a better way to proceed would be go through the question paper and divide it into clusters. So first, you should get, as Deepesh already mentioned, there are 40-50 very doable questions. So you should get those questions right. You should do with great concentration
so you
such questions.
About marking indifferently.
Yeah, marking indifferently. Try you can attempt those 50 questions and then mark remaining questions, say a box and a circle, based on how many options you can eliminate. And you can
so a box for two options which you are confused with.
Yeah.
Cross for three options,
and you can actually analyze this while doing practice. Try attempting the questions you are not very sure, and then see how many you can logically deduce, and how many you get wrong. So based on that, you can reach a optimum number of attempt.
Plus or minus five.
That varies in the examination.
What was your strategy? How many questions did you attempt?
I attempted around 95, but again, that the what Deepesh and Anurag has suggested already. I would say what was different this time, whenever I was attempting a question paper, which I was like, I attempted around 60 papers. So if I had stayed for 2 hours, I should know why I made a question correct and why I made a question incorrect. Instead of just going through numbers that, okay, I got 130 and it's good. You should know why you are getting this right and why you are not getting this right, because in the examination you would not get the direct question. You need to have that logical reasoning in your mind that, okay, if I think this way, I am getting the right answers of the questions, 48 questions which Deepesh has attempted. It's because he had developed that kind of ability that, okay, if I start from point A, I'll reach the correct answer. So this was different.
So why did you leave 5 questions? What are the reasons for leaving 5 questions?
I was not able to get any hunch. There was no gut feeling and no idea. So it's not that we were attempting that 40 questions in vain. We had some idea, we had some information, but those 5 questions were like, it was a
calculated guess.
Yeah, it's a calculated guess.
So you talked about 60 papers you solved, and this is a very new strategy that, you know, the maximum number of questions you solve, the better it gets. So you solved, let's say, 6,000 questions in your preparation. How difficult was it?
Actually, it takes a lot of time and it's a journey. Basically, you start off with, I think, around 3 months before for 60 papers, because I did not do a lot of things in the last month because that was the revision part. So you need to maintain that momentum, because in one test you might get very good marks and in the another test of another test series you might get very low marks. So what I was trying to achieve, that I should know the reasoning, whether I am able to reach the destination or not. It's the answer whether I am marking right or not. So that's why I was practicing this, the gut feeling, the hunch. I was developing that with those kind of tests.
So we understand that it is very important that you practice sufficient number of mock tests before you actually take the examination. So before that, can we share your experience in terms of how you strategized your preparation for each and every subject in terms of the relevant sources or the materials? Because when it comes to the preparation, what is very important is now you have a lot of materials available, and to clearly select the required things has become so challenging because of the flooding of materials. So can you briefly tell us what kind of sources you are referring to? And then how did you actually strategize your preparation in terms of, okay, these are all the subjects and these many questions can actually come from these subjects, and in terms of a time allocation to different subjects? So can we start with Satwik?
If I start off with polity, for example, so we have book Lakshmikant. And I think that's more than sufficient for questions which are appearing in UPSC examination. But we are not thorough with it. Revise and understand. You might not be able to understand it in one reading or two reading. Even in third reading, you might have missed some very important crucial points. So revise polity and attempt questions of UPSC previous year papers and some other test series also, so that you can at least recall whatever you have read.
So you can understand what kind of question can come from each topic.
Yes, very importantly.
So do you underline and make notes out of lexicon?
A certain portion, like for example, we have constitutional and non-constitutional bodies. I made a chart that, for example, on x-axis we had CVC, CIC, and whatever the positions are being held by the people. And then we had age, at what age who retires, and who is basically going to appoint the person, CVC, who appoints CVC or CIC. That way you will be able to recall in the examination and during test series. Apart from that, what I did for president and governor, if you are not able to make a chart, that's okay, but make a comparative study so that you at least get to know what to attempt and how to attempt. Because what happens that you are not able to recall whether president has 5 years tenures or governor has, because it's of varying degree in some other post. So polity, apart from that, I did not make any notes. It was underlined and it was multiple times I revised it.
So I think Anurag was also suggesting comparing constitutional bodies with the state.
Yeah.
You know, compare the chief minister with the prime minister.
Yeah, we can actually learn things like that. This would enhance attention, memory. So for example, there are articles which specify the powers of, say, Council of Ministers. Plus, if we add 89 to it, we get the corresponding thing for state. So such pattern will help them remember, say, articles. And this would also help in mains, because in mains answer writing also we need to sometimes
questions
specify.
Questions are also sometimes like this.
Yeah, sometimes specify the article. So such kind of memory tricks a person can use. I believe that in first reading, students should try to sort of understand the thing first rather than cramming it up. And as we proceed with second and third readings, he would be able
to... What is the ideal number of readings? 3, 4?
I think you should read it 3 times. Lakshmikant is a good book. It will help in mains preparation also. So once you get the understanding of the subject, it will continue. It will definitely help in mains. And after that, Lakshmikant is sufficient for polity.
Yes. So, as both of my friends mentioned about noting down things, so I would add, there are certain things in polity which you keep on forgetting. For example, which fundamental rights are available to non-citizens. So there are a lot of such things. I think over time you will internalize some of the stuff, and there will be some stuff which you cannot find a logic to. So it would be helpful if you write it down at one place, and just before the exam probably have a look at it. This will help you. Secondly, with regard to understanding polity, I believe even today, after 3 years, I probably do not understand polity completely. So that is
why Lakshmikant for every year. Every attempt is a new Lakshmikant.
Every attempt is a new Lakshmikant. People say that even in 7th, 8th reading, they find new stuff in Lakshmikant. So that is true, and you do not need to worry about it. And in the test series, there were certain helpful things. For example, the conceptual questions in the test series, they provide you a little more insight, because just reading the text in Lakshmikant may be at times boring and you may be overlooking some of the important things. I can give you an example. In one of the tests, there was a question of which of the following fundamental rights is absolute. Now, I read all those rights, and probably this is not specifically mentioned in Lakshmikant, the answer to this question, but it was right to untouchability. Now, people in first or second or even third reading may not look at those rights from this particular perspective, the totality of it. So try to understand stuff that will build logics, and you'll be able to remember things better.
We understand that polity, Lakshmikant has been the most important source.
Book.
And you have read it again and again so that you make sure that you get 15 to 20 questions right in the examination. So can we move to the other areas which are so important, other conventional areas? Even in conventional areas, can you break it something like these are all very important, where you have to put lot of times to make sure that you get this many marks in the examination? There are certain areas, despite putting a huge effort, still you land up not able to answer certain questions. Can you break it, Deepesh? Like the most important areas in the preparation, and then where the candidates can put a least important effort.
Yes. So I think polity, modern history, economics, and geography. These are four areas wherein, and also current affairs, I would say. These areas constitute 70% of the paper, and we can answer with a very good accuracy in these areas, probably up to 80, even 90%. So you need to allot a lot of time to these areas.
So as a percentage of time, you give the maximum to this?
Maximum to these, probably 70 to 80%. And even among these, for polity and spectrum, I would say revise these things just before the exam too. I mean, 2 to 3 days before the exam, because those links stay in your mind during the day of the exam. So that is important. For the rest of the stuff, for example, art and culture, environment, the portion beyond Shankar IAS, I mean, you cannot do much about it. They can ask from any organization anything, and you cannot do much. So
medieval and ancient history
too. So these are some of the areas you need to identify the sources, stick to them, revise them, do the test papers, and
don't expect anything.
And don't expect anything. I mean, it is same for everyone, right? So they are also doing the same sources. You too need to catch up with them on that front. And beyond that, it's up to UPSC.
Anurag, can you quickly give your experiences, the sources that you have followed for different papers, both the important things and in your opinion, which might be least important from the perspective of the examination, not in terms of knowledge, but from the perspective of examination?
Yeah, so polity we already discussed, right? And economics, I think, as far as economics is concerned, first of all, I think basic macroeconomic concepts we can do from NCERT. There are, I think, couple of chapters, 2 and 3 chapters in class 11th and 12th NCERT. A cursory reading is a must.
The new NCERT or the old one?
You can read it from the newer NCERTs. Not necessary from the old NCERT. New NCERTs are good. So two to three chapters to get a understanding of the conceptual understanding, because sometimes they ask you technical questions related to, say, inflation, tax to GDP ratio, debt to GDP ratio, such kind of questions. Then we can, after that, we can proceed with Shriram IAS. Shriram IAS has some good notes. And plus Murunal also has some very good videos. Those videos are quite long. So we can, what we can do is, we can watch two, three videos every day, and along with that, read up the same stuff from, say, Shri.
What about economic survey? Is it important for economics?
Economic survey, I would say, for prelims, that there are some of the terms in economic survey, say, headline inflation, and, you know, tax to GDP ratio, debt to GDP ratio, such kind of thing. The numbers are not very important. But the concepts are important. So I would suggest that Excellence Economic Survey is quite long, and it would take up a lot of time. It would be better to first do the theoretical and conventional part first. If you have time, then proceed with the economic survey, or you can read it up from some kind of summary also towards the end. That can also be done. But priority should be on the conventional part only, as far as the economics is concerned.
For prelims,
yeah. For mains, I think there are some good points which are there in economic survey, some out of the box solutions, understanding perspective, it is good. So mains ke liye pad sakte hain economic survey, but prelims ke liye thoda sa less priority de sakte hain isko, economic survey ko.
So, Satwik, this question is to you. So, can you add up the different sources of books apart from what Anurag and Deepesh has suggested? especially for economics and for the other subject as well. A very brief strategy that you have followed.
For economics, what I did, Shankar Ganesh book is there for basic concepts, and then you can rely upon Mrunal videos because I watch them and they are good, because sometimes visuals remain inside your head. And in the examination, I felt that there were two questions I marked with the help of Mrunal videos. Apart from that, economics is more or less current, so focus on current affairs. If we move further for geography, we can rely on NCRTs, 11th and 12th. You can skip human geography. The transportation chapter is there that one should do, because they sometimes can ask about which national highway passes through which state.
What about maps?
Yeah, map practice is very important, because they are asking one and two questions every year. And they are like a bait. You should be able to do it, because that sometimes decide your with the help of that you basically clear prelims, because they are very relevant and they are very easy questions. What you can do, you have KBC Nano in the market. Apart from that, An Academy has also uploaded some videos on map practice, which I personally followed. So that helped me to have a basic idea. You cannot pinpoint every other place.
You're also saying about Baiju's videos.
Yeah, Baiju's international maps.
Baiju or something, but so just before the prelims, a week or two, they release a video which covers the important areas that are currently in news. So the visual memory sticks in your mind, and those videos were definitely helpful.
So what about, let's say, the other topics of culture and ancient and medieval history? I know it doesn't make sense to spend time on it, but still you have to read.
Yes.
Where do you read this from?
So art and culture, I felt. So regarding art and culture, I felt that it is actually helpful in mains too, and you have to decide on certain sources and revise them. So Nitin Singhania's notes were very helpful. I revised them 5 to 6 times, in fact, and they were handy in mains too and prelims. A lot of questions stick from it. Secondly, there's a fine arts NCRT for class 11th. There are visual representations, and I mean, it's a good book. It's a nice to read book too, and it helps in the prelims. So you can stick to these two sources. Regarding ancient history, I think different sources were recommended.
Ancient. First of all, I'll say that whatever the book we are reading for fine arts, we have so many images, and UPSC has this trick that they ask. Last year there was a question on the image itself. So even if you are not able to grasp all the knowledge which is there, focus on the images, not just okay every nook and corner, but look at the images where they are exactly. And for map practice, I would say that if you are reading, everyone reads a newspaper, I believe. That if some new place is coming up, like Mosul is coming, just look at the place and the territory, geographical territory, if there is a river and some mountains are there, so in Afghanistan. And I would also say that focus on the area, the SAARC nations, because most of the time questions come from these regions, not Pakistan exactly, but Afghanistan, Nepal, Bhutan. So you get to know. This time also there was a question relating India with Malaysia. So focus on this region, because we cannot obviously cover USA. People get concerned about minerals in USA. I think that there is only 1% or less than 1% probability that the question will come from USA mineral resources. So apart from that, if we move further for ancient history, I read Tamil Nadu history NCRT book, and there is one new NCRT theme 1, 12th class 12th. That would suffice, because the return on investment is less.
If I have to add a question on Jainism, even somebody who is a practicing Jain who is very religious will not be able to understand.
Will not, yeah. So, very, very. So you need to, I think you need to know the timeline and the some very events which are known to everyone, because then you can solve the easy questions. If they are the tough questions, leave it, because that's the trick question and they are supposed to get you out of the list. Yeah, it's not worth the risk. Yeah, then you can revise the portion which Deepesh has suggested.
What about environment? What did you guys do for environment?
I think it's Shankar IAS. I made notes out of it and kept revising it till the end, because obviously they are not asking direct questions now, but if you have a basic knowledge, basic understanding of environment and ecology, you can always think in that direction. So that book is sufficient. Instead of going here and there and for multiple sources, I would say that stick to it and keep revising and be thorough with the conventions part. Because
this is a topic which has a lot of current affairs.
Yeah, that's what. That they have Minamata Convention, that then Kigali Agreement was there, whether it is changing Montreal Protocol or not, Kyoto. So be thorough with that, because that's where they can play with. Now they have started playing with numbers. So I think you need to be thorough with that part.
One thing I would like to add on environment, because since we are also focusing on forest service, so this portion becomes important, because forest service, so there are set number of questions from environment. It is guaranteed that there will be some questions from environment. Besides that, if time permits, only if time permits, we can also go through some of the reports. They are available on Ministry of Environment. If time permits, you can go through, and we can also try doing stuff like we can go through the wiki page of tiger reserves, just a cursory look at it, because it is in tabular format. It is given in wiki page on a tabular format
for the reserves which are in the borders of states.
Yeah, and biosphere reserves, there are 12 of them, or Ramsar wetlands. So such there are 10-20 places. So and on Wikipedia they are given in tabular format, so it is easy to just have a look at it. Ramsar, then bird important bird areas are there, some sites are there. So such kind of smart preparation can also be done.
So coming to the current affairs, which is considered to be one of the most important area in preparation apart from the conventional areas. So can you briefly tell us how did you strategize your current affairs preparation? Because when it comes to current affairs, there is a lot of confusion, like which to read, which not to read, and there is no dearth of materials available. So it is very important that you choose or pick a particular source which you feel will help you much, so as to avoid a reading and rereading the same thing again and again. What was the strategy?
For current affairs, related to different, so we need to follow different strategy for different topics. Like for example, science and technology, environment, we can in particular rely on current affairs notes. Vision has some very good notes. Instead of reading from multiple sources, I would suggest that read from one source and keep on revising it, because it already has plenty of contemporary current stuff, and if you are not revising it, then it would be hard to recollect, and then sometimes options are so confusing that you cannot pick the right choice.
What about the whole thing about reading newspapers? What newspapers do you read?
I read Hindu, and I believe that it's a good practice to read newspapers, because ultimately we have to write mains also. So in mains, newspapers are quite important, because the mains analytical questions are there. You need to give your perspective on things, and reading newspapers helps you build that. So it's a good practice to read newspapers before, say, a month or two before the prelims. We can start reading current affairs note with
compilations.
Yeah. So Vision has a good compilation, and so we for newspaper we need not write down everything that comes on, say, science and technology page, because there are a lot of small inventions, and you cannot mug that up that much. So for that,
someone has to decide what is important and not important in the compilation.
So in compilation, such top, for example, in science and technology, compilation provides a comprehensive coverage. Perhaps on political polity and other important economics, we can get a better perspective from newspapers also. Sometimes newspaper explains the contemporary terms also.
So regarding current affairs, as Anurag pointed out, you need to pick up some consolidated material that saves you on a lot of time, and this is extremely useful for following areas. I would say one is environment, second is art and culture too, third, the schemes part, newspaper, the coaching material that covers it very comprehensively. Economics to the scheme and the current developments, and also the terms, they are included in the material. With regard to polity, I believe for the prelims, it's mainly Lakshmikant. So there's not too much utility of the polity section. And with regard to mains for polity, I would say they provide a single source for most of the material, but you need to understand it well, and that will come from newspaper reading. So the importance of newspaper reading, I believe, is from mains perspective, which you cannot altogether cut down even during the prelims preparation. And to be more focused on the prelims, I would suggest go for the coaching material, and for that I recommend Vision to be a very comprehensive source.
So Satwik, finally, briefly, your strategy for current affairs, and also your opinion about making notes from the newspaper on daily basis, because most of the candidates have doubts whether they have to do it on daily basis, how much time they have to spend for newspaper. So briefly, your strategy about current affairs, and also the importance of reading newspaper and making notes on daily basis.
I believe when someone starts reading newspaper, they don't know what to read. That's the problem with the first comer. And so they spend around 2.5 to 3 hours every day. And sometimes they are referring to two newspapers also. And they are not making notes. So if you are reading that, you should cut it down to 1 hour maximum. Focus on, if you are, look, in the end, if you are not able to make notes, this is of no use. It's okay to just read the articles which are there, so that you can get the analysis part. Otherwise, there is no use of making reading newspaper for 3 hours. So what I did, actually, I did not have sufficient time. So what I did, I went for 3 compilations: Vision IS, IS for sure, and Insights on India. And I did not read newspaper for that 3 months. Because I had already read for 2 years, so it was like, okay, comprehension skills were there. So for mains, I again started reading. So if you are not comfortable, and if you do not know how to make notes, because that's very important, sometimes you just keep stacking comprehensions from the newspapers, and it's like 400 pages, and you do not look back. So
physical notes or online notes?
I would say go for online notes only when like offline notes is not, it's a
Deepesh
big no.
Disagrees with you on this, sir.
No, he can disagree. Like I would say online, offline notes, actually you do not write, so you just keep stacking. So actually I also threw this much bundle when I came here, so, because this was there and I did not make notes out of it.
So it's a one time thing, you write and you forget to read.
You forget. On Evernote, when you make it, you can keep changing it. So once you evolve, okay, this is not needed. So it's a big no if you do not know how to make notes. Just go for two compilations would suffice, and they will cover sufficient things, and keep revising. If you know how to make notes, it's a good thing for you.
Let's get Deepesh's work.
I think it's a trade-off. Satwik pointed out very relevant things, but I believe ultimately it's a trade-off between online notes and offline notes. While making offline notes, that is writing them down. So actually I made online notes for the last 2 years, and this year I switched to offline notes, and I could clearly see the difference. The main difference is, since you have to write it down, you are expending energy. You are more involved. And that is why you think more, you internalize more, and new ideas come up. So more than the writing part, it's the thinking part that develops while making written notes. That is what I felt.
This is the involvement versus the ability to keep updating the topic.
Keep updating the topic. So that is a trade-off. I totally agree.
I think he knew how to make notes after making
I also made online notes initially, but I also updated the strategy this year. I think it was actually good. So online notes also I used to write on my own. I did not copy paste.
People do copy paste.
Copy paste is not. It does not make sense, because if you copy paste, you are essentially not internalizing it. So you will not be able to recall. Then I think what a good strategy would be. You can make online notes if you want to, but you have to make a shorter version of it. on paper. Then it would be very handy when you have just a day to revise before, because in mains you have just a day to revise and you need to revise the entire paper. Then the paper notes would be really handy. So you can, whatever strategy suits you, there is no perfect answer for it. Whatever strategy suits the person.
So what we understand is online or offline, it is up to the candidates, but what is important is you made notes on daily basis and that helped you. And revised it, so that helped you a lot during the preparation.
And if you cannot do it, rely on the sources.
Okay, so now comes the question is like, how did you frame or manage your time? So before the prelims, to which area you actually have given more time and to which area you have reduced your time? So what was the time frame for the most important conventional areas? And those conventional areas that you found that it is not that important for the examination, and then the time frame for the current affairs. So how did you manage it? Can you all share your experience?
Choosing between when to prepare only for prelims and when to prepare prelims are optional.
We'll start with Satwik.
I'll answer this question first. When to prepare for prelims only, because it's a combined strategy, a combined study. So I think 2 months before, one should, if you really want to give for mains, it's okay to give 1 or 2 hours, but considering the fact that seats had been reduced to 750, there is, I would say that go for prelims only. It's 2 months, it's a big no for mains strategy. Apart from that, you should keep studying because they can ask anything. If there is a bill, they can ask that GST bill in mains also. They can ask something out of that bill in prelims also. So keep that thing in mind so that you don't feel that I'm studying for prelims, I'm not doing anything for mains. That is not the case. Apart from that, for prelims, you should be revising the part polity, economy, geography, environment, and current affairs, because this is the area where you can score very well. So the division of time was like that. I used to, if there is a 1 week, I have kept 1 week for this. I should be done with all these parts within 5 days. And after that, current affairs part is there. And then some that culture part is there, Nitin Singhania, and then fine arts. Because return on investment on ancient history culture is very less. So that was my strategy.
So just like Satwik mentioned, he already mentioned the division of times, the priority areas. We have discussed that polity, economy, geography, modern history are core areas. I think people can also follow this approach. That for example, we have a week, 6 days, 7 days in a week. 6 days we read new stuff, and 1 day we can keep for revision. And we can solve paper every 2-3 days. And again, on the last day of the week, we can go through all the papers we have attempted, see what mistakes we have done, and try to gauge ki what all is lacking. So this kind of approach can be, approach for revision can be followed. Revision is very, very important. So on weekly basis, you can also try it on daily basis, but it is very difficult to like revise every day. But if we keep on revising it after every week, na, to retention would be much, much better.
So what is your daily routine like? You know, do you guys get up in the morning, sit, stay late night and study? How does it work?
So I actually get up at around 8 and it's more or less studying. And whenever you feel that your energy is down or you are not...
So what, you study for 3 hours and take a break? How does it work?
Just keep on studying. You take a bath. You can decide. So that too varied across the period. So you can take a bath in the morning and then get on studying. Or you can take bath during the lunch time. Or some people don't take bath. That's also okay.
Do you have anybody in mind?
So that varies. But the point is ki you need to keep studying. That focus has to be there. Secondly, I would say that for me, power naps help me a lot. So I would take 25 to 26 minutes power naps whenever I felt that nothing more is getting into my mind.
So it's about making sure it's a power nap and not a long nap.
Yes, you have to make that sure. I mean, I know a lot of people who end up taking 2 hours sleep. So that is... yes, so that is not reliable. Third, probably we can include tests in our preparation so that it does not become monotonous. Tests are fun and you can then keep on revising stuff. And during the evening, I gave an hour and a half to myself. I would go for a jog or do something like that. It keeps you fit also, and it releases the stress hormones. So I think this will vary from person to person.
8 hours a day, 10 hours a day.
It went beyond 10 hours, I would say. But you need to understand that preparation is not just the reading the book part. Ultimately, it's about your own evolution as well. And that may involve interaction with people also. So you cannot put a number on the hours, but you need to be involved throughout the day, I would say, with UPSC.
So can you quickly tell us the amount of time that you have put in terms of percentage for the important conventional areas, say, for example, polity, history, geography, environment? And then current affairs separately, and then the non-conventional, I mean conventional, which is not important from the exam perspective, in terms of the time.
In fact, I would say the conventional areas are easier to prepare because you know the sources for it. So it would be more helpful if you give around 60-70% of your time to these sources. I mean, it's in terms of marks, directly proportionate to the marks. So polity, economy, geography, modern history, current affairs. This constitutes around 70% of the paper, to my understanding. And you can give this much percentage of time. For the rest of the part, for example, medieval, ancient culture, this is painful to read. And the sources are not so precise, so it may take up more time. So you need to put a limit. Probably stick to these sources. And also take some tests, which will throw up some new topics. And you can revise them. So you need to stick to certain sources and revise for those parts.
And how much time did you spend for current affairs? And also after that, you also let us know what is the importance of taking a mock test before the examination? And how much mock test did you take? And how did you help in improving your confidence before taking the prelims examination? Please answer this and let the others also answer.
So talking about current affairs, so firstly I'll talk about the mock test. So you can practice around 5,000, I mean the number would vary, I cannot simply put a exact number, but I think 30 to 35 tests which will cover all the static portions and the current affair portions too. So you can pick up one test series. I picked up Vision IAS, and for IAS Baba there is this 60 day program where they provide 20 to 25 questions every day. So that comes out to be around 5,000 questions. And I revised them 3 to 4 times. And you need to be you need to apply this much of common sense that this is a completely factual question with no relevance, no potential relevance. So I can skip this. So you have to apply this level of common sense while preparing. In this way, I think we can very well revise these many questions. And if we periodically give these tests, they will act as a very good revision source for what you have read.
Are you aware of the SFG program that we are doing here? We get people to come in 7 in the morning and do 50 questions every day.
That looks interesting. Can you please elaborate?
So it's basically getting up in the morning and come 7 in the morning, give 50 questions every day, 5 days a week. Okay. By the end of the program, they end up doing this many number of questions that we are talking about.
Yes, that is an interesting approach.
So one is you have a reason to get up in the morning.
Yeah.
I don't think it will work for you both of you because you get up late.
Yeah, this is an interesting thing. I mean, questions are important and you learn a lot from the questions, especially in the topics like science and technology and environment. Because questions also, science and technology, if you are, for example, he talked about IAS Baba's compilation, it is actually good for science and tech. There are a lot of things. And I think they make it from many newspapers because there are certain newspapers who follow science and tech more.
No, the thing about current affairs question is that you get out of the examination hall and feel what newspaper are there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. And I think this is more, this feeling is more there, especially for science and tech. Because this varied amount of this developments are taking place. Some newspapers cover it more, some less. So I think that is important, yes.
You did mock test.
Yeah, I did 10 to 15 mock tests, but I believe that the number is less and you should do more. You should attempt more number of mock tests. First, it would boost your confidence.
What would be too many and what would be too less?
I think 30 to 35 mock tests are more than enough. More than enough.
So you think Satwik has done too many? Satwik has done
50, 60 mock
tests. So it has worked for all of
you.
Yeah. One thing that is common is you all find that taking more mock tests has really helped you. Satwik, can you briefly tell us like how it has helped you taking this mock test?
First of all, I could not clear two prelims. So this was do or die situation for me. So I expanded my sources. Last year I attempted around 30. So this year I went for 60. So I shouldn't leave any stone unturned.
So next time you'll go for 90.
No, that 60 gave me results. So I'll go for 60. So what I would say that when I analyzed my mistakes, prior mistakes during UPSC examination, what I realized that I made mistakes in the questions which were pretty easy. The polity questions, the geography questions. I was not concerned about the part current affairs, which even if I have read it, there is a probability that I might not able to recall it. But when I realized that there were 4 or 5 questions which basically made me out of the list, they were basically from polity, geography, modern history. So while I was attempting these papers, all the 60 papers, I had in my mind, I'll not make the blunders. Whatever I have read and revised and I have on my notes, I'll not make those questions wrong. It's okay even if I do not get good marks in any test paper because they ask random questions, just like he suggested. They ask factual questions. It's okay for me to get even less than 100. But I will not make blunders. And when I say blunders, these are the questions which are coming directly from my notes, yet I am not marking the right bubble.
So what happens? Why do you think that happens? Because it comes from your notes.
It's the lack of revision. There are 4 options. So, and then they play with the options also 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 4. So, then you get confused because you have not revised it well. So, you are like, okay, you are confused on every options. If you are not, suppose 4 options are there and you are convinced that 2 options are wrong. So, at least you have a very good probability to get that question right. But if you are confused in all 4 of them, then there is equal probability the person who has not even read that question will make that question right and you will make that question wrong. So this attempt.
So revision would be the strategy to.
Revision. Revision of the questions you attempted and how did you attempt? Just like I said before, why am I getting this question right and why am I getting this question wrong? So this is what changed my opinion regarding test series, because most of the time when you attempt less test papers, you do not get to know your areas of concern. You get marks more than 110, you are happy that, okay, I'll get selected. But if you are like me, you are not getting good marks, and if you are not able to clear prelims, you can expand the sources so that you get to know where you are making wrong attempts.
So we have more or less covered everything about prelims.
Just one last question. So one of the greatest disadvantage of taking this mock test, as we hear from the candidates, is sometimes they feel really demotivated when they get to know their scores. So what is your advice to take the mock test, to take in terms of the marks, or should you have a different approach that you feel that you are really developing in your own way because of practicing the mock test?
I would say if you are getting around 50-60, then it's a cause of concern, irrespective of the test series, because that's basically showing lack of knowledge. But if you are more than 80, irrespective of the fact whether you are attempting, whether you're getting 150 or 160, do not get concerned about that. I'll tell you the real incident. I gave one test, I'll not name the test series, one week before the prelims, and I got less than 100. So a friend of mine also asked me whether he should attempt. I said, no, you should not go for that test, because sometimes people get attached to the marks.
It can happen the other way around also. You get complacent and you get very high marks.
So, that can happen. So, I think you should stick to the discipline. Whatever the, if you have made the syllabus for the week, that I will finish this, irrespective of the marks, whether you are getting 80 or 170, it shouldn't basically deviate you from the discipline part. Stick to the discipline and remain, try to, if 50-60, it's a cause of concern. Apart from that, it's okay to get even less marks.
Before we move to the mains part, Deepesh, can you quickly summarize the strategy for the prelims in terms of the time you spend, in terms of the subject, in terms of the mock test that you have taken, in terms of keeping up your motivation level on the day of the examination. Can you quickly summarize?
Yes, sure. So, firstly, I'll talk about the timeline. I would say a dedicated prelims preparation should start 50 to 60 days before the prelims. And
now is the right time.
Now is definitely the right time. And before that, I think you need to have covered all the bases because now it will be full-on prelims mode, and a lot of people have already covered a lot of stuff. I also feel that optional can be covered before the prelims if time permits. That is on a side note. Secondly, with regard to the sources, we have some standard sources for each of the subject. We pointed it out, Polity, Lakshmikant, Art and Culture, we talked about Nitin Singhania notes and Fine Arts book, Medieval History and Ancient History, we talked about Tamil Nadu book. For Modern, it is Spectrum. For Economy, sources can vary from Shriram, Shankar Ganesh and Mrunal, yes. For Geography, it's the NCRT and Mrunal videos can be very helpful. Environment is Shankar IAS. And besides that, you have to pick up a current affairs source and you have to do it at least 4 to 5 times because it will also help you for the mains. For that, I personally used Vision.
What about current affairs classes for prelims?
Current affairs classes, I have not attended it, but I feel that you may end up spending too much of a time. You have to see if it works for you.
Let's say somebody who has not done current affairs for the last 6 months, will that be a good way to consolidate their preparation?
I don't think for prelims it can be that much helpful. I don't see the logic behind it because in prelims there's a lot of stuff. It's about knowledge, right?
Satwik has done current affairs classes.
I did for me.
You did for me.
Yes, because you have to cover more and more things. That is the thing with prelims. For mains, you can understand things through the classes. So, that is my personal opinion. It can vary if it works for someone that may be the case. So, yep. And regarding keeping the motivation levels up, I would say that it is completely natural that on the day of the exam, you might not be able to get a sleep, but it is medically a fact, and a lot of us do it, that you can go without a sleep and ace the exam. I mean, that is nothing extraordinary.
You need not panic.
You need not panic that you didn't sleep on the night. That is one thing, and I mean, everybody gets nervous and everybody panics, but just try not to. That is all I can say. Whatever technique you have developed over time, maybe meditation, maybe jogging, whatever, try to resort to it, but don't panic. And yes, in the examination, I would say time management is of very utmost importance. A lot of people end up devoting too much time to certain questions. Even 4 to 5 minutes, and ultimately they'll fall short of time at the end, and they may fail to mark the questions, or they may panic when 30 to 40 questions are left. So I think within 70 minutes you should have gone through the entire question paper, 70 to 80 minutes. That can vary from person to person and the difficulty level of the exam, but that is a rough idea. And for that too, I missed the point earlier, mocks are extremely important. So you should give full length mocks and mark the circles, because those last 30 minutes when you mark the circles, that is when the last 30 to 40 questions that you were confused about, you are going to decide. And you may often feel that, let me change. Yahan bhi ye socha tha, lekin gola bharte time you end up changing it. It may pay you, it may not pay you, but you need to develop that hunch. That is most important, and that's what those mocks help you with. I made this mistake last year. I corrected it this time.
Bubbling strategy also, you need to devise the bubbling strategy, and that you can do while attempting the mocks. When you are you filling the bubbles?
Thanks, Deepesh, for that good summary of how to take up the prelims strategy. And finally, Anurag, can you tell me like what the candidate should do on the day of the examination and while doing the prelims test? Can you give them a piece of advice, like what kept you really calm and composed on the day of the examination and especially while taking the test?
Yeah, so I think try to have, don't read too much night before the exam, try to have a good night's sleep. I did not sleep well last prelims. But you need
have the Red Bull advice also.
You can have a Red Bull if you have not slept well, but don't panic. Don't read too much in the morning. Just go to the center early, relax over there, get seated with your water bottles and natural calls answered, and just relax on the seat. And during while attempting the examination, while doing the mocks, you should devise a good fill the bubble strategy. When are you going to fill the bubbles? Because sometimes in haste, what happens that you mismark a question, and that is something that you feel very guilty about, guilt is something that should be avoided. So this is very important, and time management is also important. So as and when you do mocks, you will know that whether you are overspending time on some questions or not. If you are like I particularly felt that I had a problem in the sense that suppose if I am not able to figure out between two options, and I have eliminated two options, in those questions I used to spend slightly more time in deciding, because I ultimately marked all of those questions in which I had eliminated two options. Most of the questions I attempted. So in such questions, I found out that I overspent my time. So this is something that you need to figure out in mocks and replicate the same while doing the exam. Yeah.
Thanks, Anurag, for sharing that.